Today, when people's wells run dry, they probably don't think a lot about turning to prayer to resolve the issue. You kind of call the driller out and hope that they can spot an area to dig a new well. But if any of you have ever gone through that process, and I have several times, their approaches are rather interesting. You might not really consider their approach too scientific, because the two times that we drew wells, they actually pulled out the old divining stick and went around the property. And as soon as it began to jiggle, that's where he drilled. Sure enough, he found water. Something more than perhaps high-tech methodology, but even what's behind that is a faith or conviction that the resources that we need will inevitably reveal themselves. You know, recently I was reading an account of a fellow in Japan that was trying to tackle the incredible amount of garbage that that relatively small island gathered. And one of the things that he was most concerned about was the proliferation of plastic. Maybe some of you have seen on the internet, or actually I think it has now become an advertisement on TV, of what would happen if you put all plastic bottles end to end. That they would circumnavigate the globe 190 times. So, that's a significant problem, he felt. He developed a machine that actually can be taken on an airplane that you simply stuff all of your plastic in there, turn it on, and it reconstitutes the plastic back to oil. That can be refined to make either gasoline, kerosene, or diesel fuel. What's considered waste is oftentimes simply another name for resources that have yet to be discovered. You have a really good example here in Traverse City. There is a fellow here that has developed an organization, maybe you're familiar with it, it's called BARC, Bay Area Recycling for Charities. And what he has done is basically tried to promote the idea that virtually everything that we use is 100% recyclable. What he does is, in recycling that waste, is turns the profit over to charities. Well, think about that for a moment. That recycling isn't just a matter of kind of putting your things in different bins and taking them off to the recycling center. That recycling really is a way of emphasizing that everything that we use can be reused again. That everything that we might say constitutes waste really constitutes resources. It simply requires a change of consciousness or perspective in order to see it that way. Again, I would submit to you that that is the value of prayer, is that prayer helps us change our consciousness from a preoccupation with what we assume something to be to an entirely different point of view. Now, one of the things that oftentimes happens in an environmental context is a growth of fear in thought, where people begin to be quite concerned about what is going to happen if things continue along in a certain pattern. So that's where you get predictions, especially in an environmental context, of potentially global disaster. While it's important to be aware of the impact that we have on our environment, not always do those disasters prove to be true. Frequently, we find that what happens is, again, that people change their consciousness, change their approach, and see things in a different light. There's one instance in Mary Baker Eddy's experience where she dealt, and her household lived on a farm in Concord, New Hampshire, and dealt with an approaching tornado. It came up so fast on the household, they didn't really have time to prepare, as one might normally do under those circumstances. And they simply had to congregate in the home in which they were residing. And at that point, had to turn to a response that was something more than just emergency preparedness. They had to turn to their reliance on prayer. But interestingly, the prayer in that situation wasn't so much a request for God to do something as it was an affirmation or an understanding of the divine nature. So they turned to their understanding of God as love, and the fact that this love cared for its creation, cared for its environment. And they held to that concept throughout that storm. What was interesting was the next day that when the postman came by, he acknowledged the fact that while the tornado passed through that area, that virtually no damage had been done. Well, you know, Mary Baker Eddy's reliance on that process of prayer and dealing with environmental or climatic change wasn't unique to her. It basically came from a biblical perspective. Jesus had a very similar experience in dealing with a storm that threatened the personal harm to his disciples that were in a boat as they were crossing the sea. Interestingly, when this storm came up suddenly and their fear began to develop and they appealed to him for help, he basically rebuked their fear. When he calmed the storm, he asked the question, "Why were you so afraid?" Perhaps suggesting that the disasters that seem to be accompanied by environmental action or influences may have a lot to do with the thought that goes behind them. You know, I grew up at least part of the time, in the summertime, in Oklahoma, and we lived, our ranches were in what was called Tornado Alley. And over the years, I spent a number of times in the cellar when tornadoes came along. I was always impressed, however, with how the family dealt with this issue of storm and climatic change. And very frequently, the emphasis was placed not only in protection for themselves, but also a protection for everyone that they knew. Now, one of the great, I'm sure many of you have had this experience, but one of the great experiences of living rurally is the degree to which neighbors help each other out. And how oftentimes when challenges come, people rally and they support one another. So it's not uncommon for people's attitudes basically not just to be focused on their own welfare, but also supportive of the needs of others. And those prayers reflected that concern, that they could see that this unconditional divine love was universal in its adaptation and bestowal. It didn't just shine on one group. It shined on all. I'd like to share with you, if I can get it up here on the screen, a statement from a fellow that you may be familiar with, Vasco Havel. Havel spent most of his life in Eastern Europe as a political reformer. He eventually became president of the new Czech Republic when the Cold War ended and the Iron Curtain fell. He spent a lot of his life viewing change. And here's some rather interesting observations. He says, over the past few years, the questions have been asked ever more forcefully whether global climate change occurs in natural cycles or not, to what degree we humans contribute to them, what threats stem from them, and what can be done to prevent them. Scientific studies demonstrate that any changes in temperature and energy cycles on a planetary scale could mean danger for all people on all continents. It's also obvious from published research that human activity is a cause of change. We just don't know how big its contribution is. Is it necessary to know that to the last percentage point, though? We can't endlessly fool ourselves that nothing is wrong and that we go on cheerfully pursuing our wasteful lifestyles, ignoring the climate threats and postponing a solution. Maybe there will be no major catastrophe in the coming years or decades. Who knows? But that doesn't relieve us of responsibility toward future generations. Whenever I reflect on the problems of today's world, whether they concern the economy, society, culture, security, ecology, or civilization in general, I always end up confronting the moral question. What action is responsible or acceptable? And you know, I think what Havel gets to there is an important concept about the issue of change, especially environmental change. That the reason we change can't just be because of fear of what is going to happen to us. What he's driving at is that real social change happens when there is a moral connect. When people begin doing things because it's right to do them. Not just because if they don't do them, they might incur harm to themselves. You know, it's interesting that many ethicists will point out to you that morals and ethics happen when people are not looking, not when people are looking. True morality happens because we try to do what is right, not just because people see us doing it, because that is the proper thing to do. So how do we get to that basis? How do we begin deciding, well, what is right? Certainly, one of the things that's important to understand is that what's right depends on a level of perception or understanding about what we're working with. For instance, maybe many people might think that the environment is basically the aggregate of a lot of the physical entities around us. And yet most people who work in an environmental context will tell you that the environment is vastly more than just the aggregate of physical entities. That the environment at its essence has to do with our sense of interrelatedness. And the way that we really pray about the environment is coming to understand the meaning or the significance or the substance of what is around us.